We were trying to find out a motivation. For type 1 CISO mechanism, so that in the most naive case, this mechanism implies the existence of a new particle, right-handed neutrino, and of a large scale capital M. And we found that these ingredients are indeed contained in extensions of the standard model that goes under the name of grand unified theories. So let me summarize here. Some good features of the grand unified theories. First of all, we have seen gauge coupling unification. These occur via the running of the gauge coupling constant, and we need some correction to the running of the gauge coupling constant as dictated by, let's say, the standard model particle content. If we use just the standard model running, then we come close to grand unification, but grand unification is not precise. So we need to correct this logarithmic running. And so we need some particle, some new particle between, let's say, the electroweak scale and the grand unified scale that modifies this running. Okay. And for example, there are several examples of this modification. Perhaps the most known is the one in which we supersymmetrize our model. So we have for each particle a super partner, and provided these super partner are around the TV scale, we have the correct running, and we have a gauge coupling unification. Then another advantage is particle classification. As we have seen in the standard model, we have five independent multiples of the standard model gauge group, and we don't know why we need exactly these quantum numbers. Instead, we gain some intuition going to grand unification, because for instance in SU5 one standard model family is contained into two multiples at 10 of SO5 SU5, then containing the quark doublet, the up singlet, and the electron singlet. And then we have the 5-bar containing the lepton doublet and the down singlet. Okay. So you see that quarks and leptons now share the same multiplet, the same irreducible representation of the gauge group. To describe one family in SU5, we only need two multiplets, not five as in the standard model. And this classification becomes even more remarkable, as we have seen in SO10, where the 16 representation contains a whole standard model family, Q, UC, DC, L, EC, plus a right-handed neutrino, which is the ingredient that we need for type 1 CISO. Okay. So going to a grand unified theory, we understand better why the particles, why the fermions of the standard model have the quantum numbers that we know. Okay. Another aspect that is closely related to this second aspect is the one of cancellation of gauge anomalies. We have considered anomalies of global quantities like the baryon number and the lepton number, we have seen that certain combination of these global quantities are anomalous. There is nothing wrong with having a global quantum number anomalous. That simply means that the corresponding charge is not conserved, and that we expect processes in which we will see the violation of that particular quantum number. However, instead, we cannot tolerate the presence of anomalies in the gauge current, exactly for the same reason that we saw yesterday. We cannot give up gauge invariance as a principle in building our quantum field theory, and so it's better that we check when we construct the theory that gauge anomalies are absent. And it is a kind of miracle that in the standard model the Fermi particle content is exactly what needed to have cancellation of gauge anomaly. Instead, you already see from here that the cancellation of gauge anomaly requires less condition than in the standard model, and in particular there is a whole class of groups, of gauge groups, in particular the series SO2n plus 2, which is automatically anomaly free. So no matter what is the representation in which you choose your fermions, the structure of the group automatically guarantees the cancellation of gauge anomaly. And you see from here that selecting n equal to this is precisely SO10. So in SO10 you have automatically the cancellation of gauge anomaly. Okay. Another aspect that make grand unification, grand unified theories nice is the one concerning fermion mass relations. In grand unified groups, fermions are unified in multiplets of the grand unification group, and so you expect that you are that you have less Yukawa coupling, and so interpreted in terms of Yukawa coupling in the standard model, you have a relation between the Yukawa coupling of the standard model. Let me give you an explicit example. For instance, let's consider SU5. In SU5, this is the particle content of one family. So if we are going to write down the Yukawa coupling for the charge fermions in SU5, we will write down something like that. The Yukawa couplings are, let's say, 10. Then we have a Y10. 10 again, then we need something like the X field. We need a scalar multiplet in order to create this Yukawa coupling. So let's imagine that SU5 has a 5-plet, which I call phi 5, which contains the Higgs plus a color triplet. Okay. And so to make an SU5 invariant, now I need precisely this phi 5 here. This is one Yukawa coupling. And then again, with this multiplet, I can add another Yukawa coupling, which is 5 bar, y, let me call it y 5 bar. And then I have 10, and then I have phi 5 daga. Plus Hermitian conjugate, okay. These are the two Yukawa couplings that I can write down with this particle content. And now let's see what this does it mean in terms of the Yukawa coupling of the standard model. For instance, you see the 10 here, the 10 contains the up singlet, but contains also the quark doublet. So immediately you see that what we called yesterday YU, the matrix of Yukawa coupling of the up quark sector, is simply given by Y10. we have no particular information about that, apart the fact that this is a symmetric matrix. But then when we expect this other term here, you see this 5 bar contains a DC, a down singlet, that then again contain a quark doublet, and so you see immediately that YD, the Yukawa coupling for the down quarks, are equal to Y 5 bar. Okay. But on top of that, the 5 bar contains also the lepton doublet and contains also the, let's say, the electron singlet. Okay. And so you see that if you take the transpose of this term here, you obtain the Yukawa coupling for the charged lepton. So this is equal also to YE transpose. So you find the relation between the Yukawa coupling of the charged leptons and the Yukawa coupling of down quarks, which is valid in this simple, if you wish, framework of SU5, where I have not added any other terms. You can ask if these are good relations. If these Yukawa coupling are related by a transposition, this means that they can be diagonalized by the same unitary transformation, so they will have equal eigenvalues. And if they have equal eigenvalues, you find this relation, find that the electron mass is equal to the down mass. The muon mass is equal to the strange mass, and the tau mass is equal to the bottom mass. If you take this relation as value, this relation are not fulfilled by the masses that we know. Okay. Still, you have to pay attention to the fact that this is a relation that holds, if you wish, where this theory is defined. So it holds at the grand unified scale. So it is better that you, if you wish, correct this relation by taking into account the running, by running down this relation from the grand unified scale to the electroweak scale. If you do this, some of this relation is correct. For instance, depending on the particle content, again, depending on the fact on whether the model is supersymmetric or not, depending on the values of the parameters that are there in this supersymmetric extension, this relation can be satisfied once you renormalize down the value at the electroweak scale. These are not usually verified, okay? These are not correct, but again, these are not correct by fact of order 2, of order 3. Okay, so they are not completely wrong. Imagine the fact that we know, in principle, we do not know nothing about the Yukawa coupling, no? So this Yukawa coupling could be whatever, no? The fact that we obtain relations that are valid up to factor of order 2, of order 3, at least to me, is quite remarkable. This means that SU5 providing an appropriate description of what we observed that needs some further correction. Okay, I would like to add something more on this property of grand unified theories about the fact that we can have a better understanding of the mass spectrum. Okay, even including neutrinos. But this is a very speculative subject, so let me see if I have time in the end of this lecture, I will add something more about this. Okay, let me say that despite these nice properties, we do not believe yet to grand unified theories because we have not seen an experimental proof of those theories. We are looking for something like, if you wish, a smoking gun, let's say. And in the case of grand unified theories, this smoking gun would be provided by proton decay. Okay, so we will really be convinced that the idea behind the grand unification theory is correct once we will see proton decay. Why proton decay is, let's say, peculiar of these theories? Because you see that in grand unified theories now there is no more a fundamental distinction between leptons and quarks. Lepton and quarks are in the same representation of the gauge group, so there is nothing fundamental that distinguishes between quarks and leptons. And you understand that the gauge bosons that are in the grand unified group, for instance, the gauge bosons that are in SU but are not in SU3 cross SU2 cross U1, those gauge bosons can convert a quark into leptons and vice versa. But if we can convert a quark into a lepton, we have access to proton decay. So proton decay is a generic prediction of grand unified theories. The specific predictions, I mean the proton lifetime and exactly the decay channels of these proton decay are model-dependent features that can differ from model to model. But proton decay is expected at some level in these grand unified theories. And unfortunately, so far, we have not evidence for proton decay. We have only lower bounds on the proton lifetime. The stringest lower bound has been obtained, again, by the Super-Kamiokande collaboration, looking to a particular channel, to the decay of a proton into E plus pi zero. And for this particular channel, there is a limit which is of order 10 to the 34 years. Okay, so there is no danger for ourselves. The proton is from any practical point of view stable, should be at least as aged as 10 to the 34 years. Let me give you an exercise for you. Let's try to estimate the proton lifetime. First of all, I ask you that you list all the operators, or the four fermion operators, so they are dimension six operators, that violate the baryon number. Okay, so make a list of d equals six, which are the dimensional operators, d equals six operators that violates the baryon number. Okay. Check that this list consists of four operators that are these. You have Q, UC, bar, EC bar. I'm not writing down Lorentz indices, color indices, SU2 indices, etc. So if you wish, you can reconstruct the full structure. I only writing down the fields. Then you have Q, L, UC bar, DC bar. Then you have Q, 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 L, and then you have UC, UC, DC, EC. From the field content point of view, these are the only four operators that you can write at dimension 6 that violate the baryon number. The lowest dimensional operator that violates the baryon number, because we saw that dimension 5, we have only the Weinberg operator that do not violate the baryon number. Okay. So this comes in an effective field theory description with a scale which we call lambda b squared, that is suppressed by this scale. Notice that all these operators also satisfy a selection rule, because you see that b minus l is conserved by this operator. So we have necessarily that delta b is equal to delta l. So in they can describe nucleon decay, but a nucleon should decay into an antilepton, not into a lepton. Okay. So for instance, this is a good candidate: proton decay into e plus pi zero. For instance, the neutron can decay into E plus pi minus. That's another possibility. But if I consider, for instance, the decay of the neutron into E minus pi plus, which is allowed by the conservation of the electric charge, for instance, this is not described by the operators. So if you wish, in this language, in this approach, this process should be suppressed. You are able to find an effective operator that describes this kind of process, but it will not be through a dimension 6 operator. It will be through an higher dimensional operator. So if you wish, try to look for the operator that describes also this process. Okay. Once we have this, we can estimate the proton lifetime on just on dimensional grounds, if you wish. We can we can say that the proton lifetime, if you wish, first of all, the matrix element, the amplitude square for proton decay necessarily should be proportional to 1 over lambda b to the 4. No? The amplitude goes with 1 over lambda b squared, the amplitude square with 1 over lambda b to the 4 power. Okay. And so the proton lifetime, which is 1 over the width, so I have to take the inverse of this, should go like lambda b to the 4 power. Okay. And now I need some scale in such a way that I match the right dimension for the lifetime. What scale would you suggest? Proton mass, okay. Immediately you are telling that I should put the proton mass, because this is the relevant scale here in the game. Proton mass to the 5th power. Now, this is just a dimensional, if you wish, estimate. If now we ask that a proton lifetime is larger than 10 to the 34 years, you end up with this scale, lambda b, which should be bigger to approximately 10 to the 16 GeV. 10 to the 16 GeV is a huge scale, but is exactly the natural scale that we can find in a grand unified theory. So, in a grand unified theory, precisely the grand unified scale is the scale that suppresses this operator and guarantees that the proton is stable on the scale of our experiment. Okay. Another exercise for you, the last one in grand unified theories. If you never do this, please check the unification of the gauge coupling at the leading order in, let's say, the supersymmetric version of the standard model, or in a supersymmetric grand unified theory. So, gauge coupling unification. We have three factors, SU3 cross SU2 cross U1. And so we have in principle three gauge coupling, G3, G2, and GY. Okay. So gauge coupling unification at the zero order approximation means that we have G3 equal G2 equal square root of 5/3 GY, which I can call also G1. So the first thing that I would like you to do and to work out is why I should put here a factor of square root 5/3. Okay, so think a little about it. Okay, and try to guess why should I put this factor if I, let's say, impose at a zero order the unification of the gauge coupling. Okay. This is the condition that will hold at the grand unified scale. Okay, and then I have to run down this condition at the electroweak scale. And I will do this via the one loop running. At one loop, the evolution equation is particularly simple. We have 1/(α_i)(Q). So alpha I is gi square over 4π. And I have 1/(α_i)(Q) equal to 1/(α_i), for instance, mz, suppose that I measure the gauge coupling constant at the z scale, plus bi, bi are numbers that depends on the model, over 2π logarithm of q over mz. Where the running, the information about the running is contained in this coefficient bi, and this coefficient bi for depend on the particle content of the model from the z scale on. If the model is supersymmetric, then these coefficients b1, b2, b3 are equal to 33/5, 1, and -3. Okay. So you see from this equation that if I have the boundary condition, so if I knew the common value of the gauge coupling constant at the gut scale, this value, so if I know alpha I of evaluated at m gut, let me call it alpha u, if I know this, and if I know m gut, the scale q equal to m gut, then from these three equations I can derive the value of the three gauge coupling constant at the weak scale. We cannot do this because we do know this boundary condition. So what we do? Usually we use two of these gauge coupling measure at the z scale as input of our equations. No? For instance, we use alpha electromagnetic, which is a combination of alpha 1 and alpha 2, to the -1 evaluated at the mz scale in the MS bar scheme, which is equal to 127.934. Okay. We use another combination of G1 and G2, which is sine square of theta mz. Do not confuse this theta with the mixing angle appearing in the mixing matrix. This is the Weinberg angle, okay? And this is equal to z 0.231. We use this precisely in order to compute this mgat, no? The value at which this coupling constant unify, and alpha u, the common value of the gauge coupling constant at that scale. Okay. We use this and we obtain alpha u equal to 28 alpha electromagnetic mz over 36 sine square theta of mz minus 3, and this is a number which is approximately equal to 1 over 25. Showing you that, at least in this leading order approximation, you are still in the perturbative regime, so you are allowed to use one loop evolution equation. Then you find that the log of mgat over mz is equal to pi 3 minus 8 sine square of theta evaluated at mz over 14 alpha electromagnetic of mz. So you can derive from this equation, and you find that mgat is approximately equal to 2 times 10 to the 16 GV. And you have used a combination of alpha 1 and alpha 2 at the z scale. Now that you have derived alpha gat, you can use the third equation to predict the third gauge coupling, to predict alpha 3 at the z scale. And what we obtain, so this is a prediction now, you obtain that alpha 3 of mz is equal to 7 ms bar scheme 7 alpha electromagnetic of mz 15 sine square theta of mz, and this is equal to 0.118, which is more or less exactly what is measured, okay, at the z scale. So this is an example of a good prediction that tend to receive the bad corrections, in the sense that this is very naive. We work out this prediction in the one loop running approximation, but of course people started to include further correction, to include the correction from the two-loop running, to include also the threshold effect that comes from the variety of particles that can exist at the grand unified scale, the particles that are around the TV scale, etc. Try to refine this correction. If you wish, the message is that this value, is still compatible with the experimental data, but the prediction acquires a large error, because we don't know exactly, there are many effects that we do not control exactly, if you wish. So, this is what I wanted to say about grand unification theories. Have you any question on this topic? Please.
So coupling, this running coupling, do you use the one B coefficient of MSSM?
Yes, I'm using the MSSM coefficients.
So
or if you wish, I have in mind a supersymmetric version of my grand unified theories, for instance, SU5, where everything has been supersymmetrized. And as far as the particle content is concerned, from the electroweak scale, let's say from the TV scale on, when presumably are the supersymmetric particle, up to the grand unified scale, I have the spectrum of MSSM. And it's this spectrum that controls the evolution of the gauge coupling. In the standard model, I have slightly different values for those BI, and that's make the unification working not so well. Not so well. The alpha electromagnetic and sine square meet at 10^14 GV scale, and then you get the wrong value for the strong coupling constant.
Okay. Am I right that grand unification theories are not the only possibility of existence of stellar neutrinos?
Yes. Grand unified theories, for instance, in SU5, there is no necessity of a stellar neutrino, and I can add a stellar neutrino, but I add to SU5 by hand, let's say. And similarly, I can, when I declare what is the particle content of a model, I can add a sterile neutrino, let's say, more or less by hand. You are asking me if there is any other compelling reason to have a right-handed neutrino which is sterile?
No, I'm asking about can we have sterile neutrino but not go into the good scales?
You mean a sterile neutrino which is lighter?
For example, yes.
Yes. Yeah, we can have lighter sterile neutrinos. For instance, if we just imagine that we have a first step of unification, which is not a unification into a simple group, but is, for instance, a unification into a left-right symmetric group. So if we consider SU2 left cross SU2 right cross U1 as a first step in the direction of the unification, then in this case the particle content that includes a right-handed charged leptons automatically include also a right-handed neutrinos. The right-handed neutrino is charged under SU2R cross U1. But if this part of the gauge group is broken, for instance, is broken at the TV scale, as a consequence, you have a right-handed neutrino whose mass is approximately close to the TV scale, and that, from the point of view of the standard model, is a sterile neutrino, because at low energy you don't see anymore the gauge, if you wish, interaction of that particle.
Thank you.
If there are no more questions, let me now, I have told you many good points of grand unified theories, let me also tell you some bad points. A bad point is that the full theory is extremely difficult to test. So let me consider just type 1 CISO. Let's go back to type 1 CISO, step back. Type 1 CISO is a nice idea, but it is very difficult. To test. And to see this, we should go back to the full Lagrangian of this theory. The full Lagrangian contains the Yukawa coupling of the neutrino, nu c, y nu, phi tilde daga, doublet. Then we have the mass term for the right-handed neutrinos, plus Hermitian conjugate, and we can do a counting of the parameters that are in this Lagrangian. We will do in a moment the counting in another context when I will tell you about leptogenesis, okay? But believe me that if we do correctly the counting, we find that this Lagrangian contains 6 parameters that describes masses, 6 masses, 6 mixing angles, 6 angles, and 6 phases. Whereas we know that at low energy, if we forget about the right-handed neutrinos, we have seen that we have just the 3 neutrino masses, the 3 mixing angles, and at most 3 phases. So you saw with the number of parameters, we have 18 parameters. So if we want to test this idea, in principle, we have to measure all these 9 parameters that are beyond the low energy parameters. And this is very difficult if the scale that is implied by the presence of this particle is so high as the grand unified scale. Okay. It is much easier to test, if you wish, what is the low energy remnant of this theory that, as we saw last time, is the Weinberg operator. Okay. Easier to test. The Weinberg operator. With the specification that, however, as we saw, the Weinberg operator is a universal operator, no? It's an operator that does not know about the detail of the mechanism. It is the same, no? No matter if CISO is of type 1, of type 2, of type 3, whatever, no? We have the same Weinberg operator, which is unique. So, if we test the Weinberg operator, in a sense, we test the idea that the lepton number is violated, but we do not test exactly the detail of the high energy theory that can be different for the different mechanism. Okay. However, to test the Weinberg operator, since the feature of the Weinberg operator is that it violates B minus L by 2 units, we should look to some process in which, for instance, the lepton number is violated by 2 units. And there is a particularly interesting process to which our experiments are sensitive to, which is the neutrinoless double beta decay. This consists in a transition in which you have a nucleus with atomic number A, Z proton, that goes into another nucleus with 2 more protons by the emission of 2 electrons without any neutrinos. So you see that precisely this process violates the baryon number and mi minus L by 2 units. Okay. It is not so easy to find, if you wish, a candidate nucleus that can satisfy this property in principle, because you have, first of all, to satisfy some kinematical requirement. A nucleus will tend, an unstable nucleus will tend to decay via usual beta decay, no? By emitting just one electron and one neutrino. So you should find a nucleus for which the normal beta decay is forbidden for kinematical reason, and the next available decay is precisely the one in the number of protons is by 2. So let me give you an example. For instance, if you consider germanium 76, that contains 32 protons, this cannot go into arsenium 76 with 33 protons, because this nucleus is heavier than this one, so this is forbidden. But the germanium can go, so again, germanium 76, 32, can go into selenium 76 with 34 protons. This is allowed because this nucleus is lighter than this one. So this transition is possible. Of course, if this transition is possible, it is also possible the one with emission of 2 antineutrinos. So if this is possible, also the other transition giving Z plus 2 plus 2 electrons plus 2 antineutrinos, also this will be possible. Okay. So what one is looking for is something like that. Imagine that we perform an experiment, a counting experiment. We count the number of nuclei that decay as a function of the energy of the two electrons. Okay. We will find this contribution, the one which conserves the lepton number, okay, which will be the dominant one, and will give you a spectrum like this, for instance. And then we are looking for another contribution, which is this one, in which the two electrons, the sum of the energy of the two electrons is a fixed energy, because it's simply the Q value of this reaction. And so we are looking to a, if you wish, to a monochromatic line of this type at the end of this spectrum. Okay. This is a very difficult experiment. There are several ongoing experiments. Let's see what combination of parameters are we sensitive in this kind of transitions. You see, from the point of view of Feynman diagrams, the diagrams that dominate this particular transition, let me come back now to the SO mechanism, is this one. No, we have to produce two protons more, so we start from a down, we go to a up. Then we emit a W minus. The W minus goes into an electron. And here I have the same, if you wish, kind of transition. We have a down going to an up, emitting also a W minus. The W minus converts into an electron. And then here I have a neutrino. Let me call neutrino K. Sorry, this is a light neutrino. I do not need to specify the type of SO mechanism. This is a light neutrino, okay? And so you see from here, amplitude for this process is proportional to what? Here, in the charge current interaction, I will have the mixing matrix, no? I will have U, E, K. No, if I am emitting here a neutrino mass eigenstate of type K. But I have twice this factor, because I have once this factor here and once this factor here. So I have UEK here, UEK, and this makes an UEK square. But then I have, if you wish, to put something that gives me the information that the lepton number is violated. And that information is precisely contained in the Weinberg operator, is the mass of the neutrino. And so here I have to put the mass of the neutrino K. And I have to sum over all the possible neutrino that I can exchange in this line. So if you wish, the diagram is like that. Here there is the insertion of the neutrino mass. I have to sum over K. And so this is the quantity I'm sensitive to at the level of amplitude. But this quantity, if you work it out, is nothing but the EE element of the neutrino mass matrix. If you take the neutrino matrix and you pick up the EE element, let's say in absolute value, this is precisely this quantity here. So this process at the level of the amplitude is sensitive to the EE element of the neutrino mass matrix. We can work this element out because we know the parametrization, the standard parametrization of the mixing matrix. We call the masses M1, 2, M3, and so we end up with the with an expression for MEE, which is equal to cosine square of theta 1 3 times cosine square of theta 1 2 times M1 plus sine square of theta 1 2 times M2 plus sine square of theta 1 3 e to the 2i beta. Sorry, I forgot the phase. Let me go back here. So sine square of theta 1 2 times e to the twice I alpha m2 plus sine square of theta 1 3 e twice I beta M3. Okay. This is the combination that we obtain by explicitating this term here. And I show you this because I want to emphasize the fact that now there are two phases that are present. These phases are combination between the Majorana phase and the Dirac-like phase, but precisely they depend on those phases that do not enter neutrino oscillation. Okay, you remember that for the probability neutrino oscillation, there were two phases that never enter. Those two phases now enter here. They are in alpha and beta. So with this process, we are sensitive to that part of the mixing matrix and to the, as we say, Majorana nature of the neutrino. I even tried to estimate what MEE could be, because we know a lot of things, no? We know what are mixing angles. We have an idea about the masses, and so we can try to get an idea of what is the order of magnitude of this MEE quantity that we are going to measure. So let me, for instance, consider the case of inverted ordering, in which, so the inverted ordering, I have the third level here. Here I have the first two levels. Okay. Let me set the third level to zero. So I consider the case in which M3 is equal to zero. And in this case, you see that MEE is equal to what? Let's put theta 1,3 to 0, okay, just to have an idea. So this cosine is equal to 1. So we have cosine square of theta 1,2 times m1. Now m1 and m2, if this is 0, they are approximately equal to the square root of delta m square atmospheric, okay, with a little difference. So this is equal cosine of theta 1,2 square root of delta m square atmospheric. And then I have this other contribution plus sine square theta 1,2 e to the I twice I alpha, again square root of delta m square atmospheric. And so you see that I have delta m square atmospheric, that is approximately 0.05 electron volt, times this cosine is equal to 2/3 plus e to twice I alpha times 1/3, that's the sine of the solar mixing angle. So this is a number that goes from 1/3, from 0.3, to approximately 1. Okay, so this MEE is a quantity which is in the range 17 to 50 milli electron volt. Okay. I let you to complete the exercise. Let work out also, for instance, the estimate for MEE in the case of normal hierarchy by setting the lightest neutrino mass to zero. And I gave you more or less the qualitative picture of this. If you plot now this parameter, MEE in absolute value, versus the lightest neutrino mass, which is M3 in the case of inverted ordering and M1 in case of normal ordering, okay, you obtain something like that. This is in electron volt. Also, this is in electron volt. Here you are 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 2. Okay. So inverted ordering is a band like this. This band is both due to the fact that we have error, experimental errors on those parameters, and on the fact that we have a phases, and we let the phases vary from 0 to 2 pi. Okay. So this is the prediction for the case of inverted ordering, okay. And then we have normal ordering. Normal ordering is something like that. Okay, here you have about 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 2. Okay, so this is a normal ordering. You see that at the particular values of the lightest neutrino mass, you may have cancellation among the terms that you saw in the previous formula, and you can go down even to very small values, even to zero in principle. And then the present orbital bound are here, more or less, at the level of 10 to the minus 1. Here are the bounds. So this part here is excluded. And concerning the lightest neutrino mass, we have a bound coming, for instance, from cosmology, as we have seen, of the order of 10 to the minus 1 or so. So we have also here a bound, which is less clear, coming, for instance, from cosmology. So So you see that measuring the neutrinoless double beta decay would be an extremely important piece of information, because first of all, it would tell us that the lepton number is violated, and so the description through the Weinberg operator and in principle through some kind of CISO is the correct description. And more or less, if we have some knowledge of the point in this plot, we know at the same time, if you wish, this particular parameter, but we have also a knowledge about the kind of ordering of neutrino masses. So this would be really an important, a very important, let's say, result. I tell you that there are bounds up to now. There are many experiments that are looking for this process. Unfortunately, it's not so easy to go directly from the result, because the experiment measures a lifetime, gives a bound on the lifetime of the nucleus. But if you want to go from the lifetime of the nucleus through this parameter, this is the parameter of interest for particle physics, you have to deconvolute this parameter from the nuclei property, and you have to know in particular the nuclear matrix elements. And those are difficult to estimate in this kind of processes. So in general, you have a large uncertainty when you try to derive some information from the data, and you want to convert this information directly in this parameter here. However, there are several experiments at the moment that would like to go to this level of sensitivity, the level of sensitivity of the inverted hierarchy. Okay, again, this ends another chapter. I would like to move now to a completely different topic, which is leptogenesis. And so again, if you have any question on neutrinoless double beta decay, please ask me.
Is there any part? Is there any possibility that once beta decay happens, and the neutrino it will capture again before the escaping the nucleus?
Sorry, I haven't got the second part of your question. The neutrinoless double beta decay happens.
Once beta happens, and this might be happen or not?
Sorry, I haven't got completely the question. I don't know. If the question is there any other mechanism that can produce this kind of effect?
So what I say is that one can be reabsorbed into the nucleus, right? If that diagram is right.
If the diagram is right, what you are looking for is the final electrons. Mm-hmm. So you look for a little deviation, a little bump, which is on the tail of the spectrum, of the energy spectrum of the electron as emitted in the neutrino double beta decay. This is the experimental signature. Mm-hmm. Of course, since this effect is really little, because this is suppressed by the neutrino masses, as you saw. This can be buried under many other effects, many other lines that are there, not of because of the process you are observing, but because of radioactivities that you have around in your experimental apparatus. And so it is a huge fight in order to kill all the other lines and to understand and to identify all the other lines which are around the line that you are looking for. And unless you are 100% sure that the line you have identified is not coming from some other subtle effect, you will not be convinced that neutrinoless double beta decay have occurred.
So background is very complicated.
The background is extremely complicated because this effect is a tiny effect on the tail of a huge...
So they only checked and the monochromatic signals for the spectrums.
Exact.
I see.
So the bound from cosmology in this plot, could you perhaps say a few words about that? And are there any prospects for moving this line?
Yes, there is a limit coming from cosmology. So this limit is becoming more and more severe, but it is also, let's say, kind of model dependent because it depends exactly on your assumption on the cosmological model that you include in your analysis. Also, cosmologists tend to consider different sets of data because they believe that a certain set is more robust, is more trustable than another set. So depending on the group that is performing this kind of analysis, you see that there are different bounds. However, taking into account this uncertainty, which is pretty large, data seem to converge with an upper bound on the sum of neutrino masses, which is of order of 0.2 electron volt, which is stronger than the bound that we have now from the lab. Now, from the lab, we have a limit on the neutrino mass, which is around 2 electron volt, so it is one order of magnitude above. From cosmology, we have a stringent bound, but we don't know exactly where we should put this line because there are uncertainties which are difficult to evaluate. And I'm not an expert on this, so I'm just referring you to what is my impression.
Thank you.
Okay, if there are no more questions, let's move to another topic, which have to do with leptogenesis. Let me begin this, and then we will see if we have time to finish, or we will finish this tomorrow. So this is leptogenesis is another virtue, if you wish, of the CISO mechanism. And here I will consider type 1 CISO as a guide, which is simple to discuss. You know that we observed a baryon asymmetry, which is baryon number density minus the antibaryon number density over the photon density, which is a number that has been measured in different, if you wish, context, and without going into details, but is close, let's say it's close to 6 times 10 to the minus 10. So it is a tiny number. We would like to see if it is possible to generate this asymmetry starting from symmetric conditions, so starting from a universe in which this number at the beginning is equal to zero. Okay, and if we want to do so, you know that we should satisfy three conditions that are the Sakharov condition. If at the beginning of the universe this asymmetry was zero, first of all we need that the baryon number is violated. Okay. Second condition, we need that the charge conjugation and CP are violated. Okay, I think that the first is evident, no? The second, the CCP should be violated because otherwise we would produce the same amount of baryons and the same amount of antibaryons via baryon violating effects with a net zero asymmetry, so this is necessary. And third, we should have the universe in which the relevant processes are out of equilibrium. Out of equilibrium, because otherwise, if you wish, if the processes are all in equilibrium, then the processes that would create a net baryon asymmetry would have the same rate also in the opposite direction, and so they would tend to wash out the asymmetry that has been created. Okay, so we need these three conditions. And indeed, these three conditions are realized in particular in the type 1 CISO theory that I will consider here as an example. Because, well, first of all, we know that B minus L is violated. By the right-handed neutrino mass. Okay. This could create a lepton asymmetry, no? Via the decay of the right-handed neutrino, as we will see in a moment. This lepton asymmetry then can be converted during the history of the universe partially into a baryon asymmetry, because we saw at the beginning of these lectures that in the standard model the baryon and the lepton number are anomalous. In particular, B plus L is anomalous, so there are processes in the standard model that violates the baryon and the lepton number. They conserve B minus L, but they violate B plus L. Via this process, a part of this lepton asymmetry can be converted into a baryon asymmetry. Okay. Second condition, C and CP are violated in type 1 CISO. To do this, we should check if the CISO Lagrangian has a sufficient number of phases, because you know that are the phases that are attached to the violation of, for instance, the CP symmetry. So let's go back and count the number of parameters that are in the CISO Lagrangian. CISO Lagrangian, so we have, let's say, the Yukawa coupling. Let's consider also the Yukawa coupling for the charge leptons. So counting the parameters of the CISO Lagrangian. So we have the Yukawa coupling minus EC YE phi daga L minus nu C Y nu phi tilde daga L minus 1/2 nu C M nu C plus Hermitian conjugate. Let's count the number of parameters that are contained at the beginning in this Lagrangian. No? We have two matrices, 3x3 matrices, YE and Y nu, that are complex. So 3x3 is 9. 9 times 2 is 18. We have 2, so we have 36 parameters. in these two matrices. We have another matrix M, which however is a symmetric, as you see from here. So we have six elements times two because it's complex. So let's make 12 parameters. So we have 48 parameters to start with, which are, if you wish, 24 moduli plus 24 phases. And now what we are interested in is to see how many of those phases are physical. You know that the physical phases are those that cannot be eliminated via a redefinition of the fields. Okay. A field redefinition does not change the physical content of my theory. It's just a change of basis. If I perform a field redefinition, I'm simply using another language to describe the same physics. So now I'm using field redefinition to see how many phases I can eliminate from here. What are the most general field redefinition that I can perform? I can perform a unitary transformation omega EC on the field EC. This belongs to U3, because remember, here I have not written down the family index. EC is really a multiplet, first, second, and third generation. And so I have a U3 matrix, okay, that leaves the kinetic term invariant, but perform a transformation, a base transformation. Similarly, for nu C goes into omega nu C, another U3 matrix, and then eventually L going into omega L, another U3 matrix. So I have three U3 matrices, okay? U3 contains how many parameters? We know 9 parameters, 9 parameters for each U3. So we have a total of 27 parameters that we can eliminate from those via this redefinition. These 27 parameters are three angles and other three angles, so we have 9 angles, plus 18 phases. So the angles, I should subtract them from here, and the phases from here. So you have a total of 15 moduli and 6 phases. Okay? What is the physical interpretation of the 15 moduli? These 15 moduli are the 9 masses because I have the charged leptons, I have the light neutrinos, and I have the heavy neutrinos, 3 generations, so I have 9 masses, and then I have 6 mixing angles, okay, that makes 15, and then I have 6 phases. Okay, and now I have to, if you wish, to subtract the number of phases that are present at low energy, that are, again, 6 masses, 3 mixing angle, and 3 phases, okay? And so I remain with high energy, I mean, an energy scale which is relevant for the dynamics of the right-handed neutrinos. I remain with 3 masses that are the masses of the 3 heavy neutrinos, 3 angles, and 3 phases. Okay, and those are the phases that violate CP on top of the low energy phases that I have in my theory. So you see that I have a sufficient number of phases so that in a high energy process involving the right-handed neutrino, CP and C are violated. Okay. Please. the CP violation in the standard model is not enough because we should see if the three Sakharov conditions are fulfilled. The first, in principle, is fulfilled because we have a violation of baryon lepton number through the anomaly. We have also CP violation in the standard model. We have to check if we have processes that are out of equilibrium. And if we go into detail and we check if this third condition is satisfied, we see that in the history of the universe, such a condition is satisfied only if the electroweak phase transition is a first order, is a violent phase transition, is not a smooth transition. To check if this phase transition is a first order, you have to look to the scalar potential. Essentially, it depends on the details of the scalar potential of the standard model. But in the standard model, it happens to be first order only if the X has a mass below 80 GeV. So it was possible some years ago, today is no more possible. So we should go beyond the standard model to satisfy these three Sakharov conditions. Okay. By the way, perform the same trick here to count the number of parameters that are in the quark sector in the standard model. No? So exercise for you. Use exactly the same reasoning in order to count the number of parameters that we have in the quark sector in the standard model. In the standard model, you know that we have six masses, the up and the down sectors, three mixing angles, and one CP violating phase. Okay, so a total of 10. The same trick, and you will arrive at another number. So try to understand why this happens, why this reasoning does not work anymore, or how this reasoning should be adapted to the case of the standard model. Okay. Few minutes. So we saw the first condition and the second out of equilibrium. So let me mention something about out of equilibrium. First of all, what are the processes we have in mind to generate this lepton asymmetry that then is converted into a baryon asymmetry? We have in mind the decay of the right-handed neutrinos. In the simplest possible case, let me imagine that two right-handed neutrinos are very heavy and they do not participate to these transitions. And let me focus on the lightest right-handed neutrino, which I call nu1, the lightest. Okay, and the processes I have in mind is the decay of the right-handed neutrinos into via this Yukawa coupling, you see, into a lepton X pair, or since the lepton number is violated, this can all so decay into a anti-lepton and phi star, if you wish. Okay. So I'm interested in these processes. Okay. And so what does it mean that these processes are out of equilibrium? They will be out of equilibrium if the rate is sufficiently small compared to what? Compared to the expansion of the universe. Okay, if the rate processes occur is not larger than the expansion rate of the universe, this means that this particular process go out of equilibrium. So the out of equilibrium condition can be estimated by the requirement that the rate, for instance, for nu1 c into L phi, these processes have a different rate, but the difference is tiny, so I can consider one of them, is smaller compared to the rate of expansion of the universe, which is the Hubble constant, which is, if you wish, temperature square over the Planck mass, evaluated at the relative temperature scale, which is temperature equal to M1, the mass of the first right-handed neutrino. So, let me explicitate this condition. So, what is the diagram that dominates nu1 c into L phi? It is this diagram here. I have nu1 c, a lepton of flavor A, and phi. I should create a lepton, so I should consider, if you wish, y dagger. So the amplitude for this process is proportional to y dagger, to y dagger A1, okay? And so the width for the decay nu 1c into lepton phi, if I sum over the final state LA in the simplest version of this mechanism, this is y dagger matrix element 1 1. I have sum over A here, and then I have M1 over 8 pi. Okay, this is it. I should ask that this rate is less than, you see, M1 square over 8, over, sorry, M Planck. Okay, and so you see that, can simplify this, this M1 I put it here. Then I multiply this by V square, the VEV of the Higgs square. And then I obtain the following inequality, y dagger, 1, 1, V square over M1, which should be smaller than a number, which is 8 pi V square over M Planck, which is a combination of the electroweak scale and the gravitational coupling. This is a fixed number, which is of the order of 10 to the minus 3 electron volt. And this, you see now, is quite close to our expression for the neutrino mass, no? The neutrino mass from the system mechanism is precisely quadratic in the Yukawa coupling, is proportional to V square and inversely proportional to the mass of the right-handed neutrino. So this is a kind of neutrino mass. We can call it M tilde 1. And you can demonstrate that this M tilde 1 is bigger than the lightest neutrino mass. And so we learn that if we want to realize this out of equilibrium condition, it is better that one of the neutrinos is sufficiently light, is smaller than 10 to the minus 3 electron volt. In reality, this estimate is a rough estimate, and you should put dynamics inside to get the right bound. And if you do things correctly, you find that M lightest should be smaller than about 0.1 electron volt. So it is quite remarkable, and I stop here, that from this consideration, in the simplest possible case, because there are many variants of this idea, many different implementations of leptogenesis, but I find it quite remarkable that in the simplest possible case, we end up with a requirement that gives us an information on the lightest neutrino mass that is perfectly compatible with what we know from the experiment. Okay. Sorry, I go a little bit over time. If you have any question, please. Okay, so we stop here.